Isn't it a beautiful day to be in God's house? Amen? Oh, we had a little bit of a tech gremlin here over the last few days. Somehow our soundboard erased itself between Thursday's practice and today. So we've got folks working on it. But I know y'all appreciate how much they do, and we're just going to do the best we can. So thank you all for joining us here this morning. I am so blessed to be able to spend this time with you today. For those who are joining us at home and online, we are blessed by your presence as well. So now, as we begin our worship time together, I would love to invite you all to stand as you're led and able and join us in our opening song today, Battle Belongs.
You see my victory when all I see is the mountain. You see a mountain moved as I walk through the shadow. Your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear.
Does belong to you. Without you, we can do nothing. And we thank you, Lord God, that you are a God that is willing to do it for us. Lord, you call us saints, you call us warriors. That's who you say we are. And we take humility and joy from that. So, Lord God, as we sit here today, let us remember that we are saints, we are warriors, and more importantly, you call us children. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, I'd like to invite you all to go ahead and have a seat as we share just a few announcements for today. Hey, Andrew, can you pull my volume down just a tiny bit? Thank you, sir. All right. Next week is our kickoff Sunday. So we are inviting you all to come back for our one service at 10 a.m., 10 o'clock right here, 10 o'clock, not 9:40 or 8:15 or 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock right here. And then we will be having a connection fair afterwards down in Wesley Hall, so we invite you all to come along and see what is in store for us throughout the upcoming fall season and to find what is calling to you for a place to fit in and to belong here at St. Mark's over the upcoming year. So please be sure to join us then. And then on the 25th, what time is everybody going to be here for the current? 11 a.m. for the current. 9 o'clock is our traditional service. 10 o'clock will be a fellowship and Sunday school hour and Christian discipleship. And there are opportunities and a place for everyone. So please be sure to check out the information on the tables in the gathering area and what you can learn next Sunday in our Connections Fair for what might be calling to you for a place to fit in for that 10 o'clock hour. And then we'll see you here at 11 for the current. A couple of things that I wanted to highlight that were in our announcements today. Please be sure to take a look at that blue section, especially for all of the things that are upcoming. But one of them, as a response to requests from many people in the congregation, we are in the process of putting together a new photo directory. So if you take a look there, there will be times to be able to sign up for a slot to have a photo taken. I do believe they can submit photos as well. Would that be correct? No? There we go. I'm like, where's Missy? Okay, so let's go back. There are going to be slots to sign up for pictures to be taken. So please gather your family together, sign up for a slot for that new pictorial directory so that we can get everybody included in there so that we can be all together part of St. Mark's family. Check out the fall studies and missional opportunities that are coming up, and there are many of them, as there always are. And speaking of missional opportunities, I would love to invite Amy to come up to share with us a little about... an upcoming opportunity. Handheld one.
Okay, good morning, everybody. I just wanted to take a few minutes to ask you all to prayerfully consider joining us yet again this year for Potato Drop and Mission in Action Day weekend, which is coming up. On Saturday, September 28th, will be our Potato Drop, which is done along with the Society of St. Andrew. And then our Mission in Action Day will take place the following day, Sunday, September 29th. So these are just some photos from sometimes over the last couple years. This shows Potato Drop. The semi in the back has all these potatoes on these skids that get unloaded. We gather, get some instruction from our fearless leader, Wayne Ewell, and then we start unpacking potatoes. We have people that come, individuals from the community who are food insecure. We have food pantries from all over central Indiana, that come because right now food is a major need for so many people. It continues to be. So we load these potatoes up. They get taken where the need is. And they get distributed. And also sometimes we have apples that come. In fact, last year we had two big, huge crates of apples, and we bag those up. They come from local orchards. They get gleaned, and that shows us getting the potato or the apples out. And then that's like an additional just kind of perk that they get that when they come, is they can also pick up some apples. So last year we distributed almost 40,000 pounds of potatoes and almost 5,000 pounds of apples. So the need is great. We need you here to help. This shows what we do on Sunday morning. We gather here at church. We come into Wesley Hall, get a little snack, some coffee, meet with your friends, have a little fellowship, say a prayer, and get sent off out into our community to be the hands and feet of God at some of our various mission partners. For instance, Roberts Park, the Soups On program, where we serve, cook and serve lunch to the homeless who are served by Roberts Park UMC. We had a group last year that went to Fletcher Place. They sorted some donations and helped kind of reorganize their pantry space. Then that shows what they were doing there. And then we had a group that went down to East 10th Street, Children and Youth Center, and they did hard work laying new mulch for their playground. So we have all sorts of off-site activities just like that. We also have some on-site activities. Last year, we created some hygiene bags to give out to those people who were served by Roberts Park, the Soups On program. We also made some mission mailbox cards for shut-ins and the people, other various partners that we have in the community who can use those to send out. So we are a place where mission is a way of life. We want everybody to find a place to get involved. There's something for everyone. I encourage you to go ahead and sign-ups are available now. You can go to stmarkscarmel.org/MIA-day, and that's also in the blue section of your bulletin, and you'll see what all the different opportunities that we're going to have this year, and we just hope that you find some way to plug in and join us for that incredible weekend. Thank you.
Thanks, Amy. It is such an important part of what we do here at St. Mark's, and this is a day that we get to celebrate and to be able to work together, as Amy said, to be the hands and feet of Jesus right here in our community and in our area, helping those that we see each and every day. So, and with that, I would like to invite y'all to take a moment just to greet your neighbors, maybe meet a new friend on the other side of the sanctuary, and pass Christ's peace this morning.
We can handle it.
We actually were meeting friends on the other side of the sanctuary. I love it.
Oh,
Well, welcome once again, everyone. We are back today continuing our series based around one of my favorite books of all time. And I've heard from a number of you over the past week now that it's at the top of your lists as well. Now, you might be interested to learn that we fans are apparently in pretty good company when it comes to this book. Back in the fall of 2018, the results of PBS's Great American Read Survey were announced. That survey involved more than 4 million votes being cast during a 6-month-long national poll that ultimately identified To Kill a Mockingbird as the U.S. best love novel of all time. So let's dive in. Can we start the video? I have a friend, another United Methodist pastor, who grew up as a pastor's kid. Her mom was a pastor and had served for a while as a district superintendent in their conference out east. Now, for those who aren't terribly familiar with our United Methodist structure, the district superintendents serve as an extension of the bishop's office, part of the bishop's cabinet, overseeing the work of other pastors and the churches that are in their defined geographic areas. My friend shares a great story about a time during which her mom was the superintendent. While she was serving in this pretty high profile role, her mom decided to take a Spanish class. Now, during the time that she served on the cabinet, she and the other district superintendents and the bishop shared many meals together as they worked far away from home quite often. For one such meal, they found themselves at a Mexican restaurant, and wanting to use her newfound linguistic skills, my friend's mom ordered in Spanish when the server came around to take drink orders. I'm sure she felt quite proud of herself, using those classroom skills in a real-world environment. So pretty soon, the server came back with the drinks, and my mom and my friend's mom fully expected to get the Diet Coke that she had ordered, or that she thought she ordered. Instead, the server handed her a Coors Light. It was a simple enough mix-up, I suppose, but probably not the impression that you're looking to make while you're dining with the bishop. You see, words matter. In this case, words were misunderstood, or maybe my friend's mom just looked like she needed a beer. It had been a long day. To this day, she swears up and down that she ordered a Coca Light, which is the correct way to say Diet Coke in Spanish, but that is obviously not what the server heard. And doesn't that so often happen with words? I mean, I swear, Pete and I can have a conversation, and 30 seconds later, when one of us tries to rehash some part of it, the other will invariably say, "That's not what I said." And then when what was actually said is clarified, the response will be, "Well, that's not what I heard." I hear the nod, I see the nods and laughs. It doesn't happen to any of you ever, right? It's as if what we say and what is heard are two completely different things sometimes. Now, our words might not always be interpreted exactly as they are intended, but still, our words matter. So last week, we talked about Scout Finch, the six-year-old narrator in Harper Lee's To Kill a Mockingbird. Now, one of Scout's endearing traits is that she does not mince words. She says exactly what is on her mind, no matter how socially disgraceful it might be. Her father, Atticus, on the other hand, who is portrayed by Gregory Peck in the film adaptation, is a much better wordsmith. Now, as a lawyer, you would expect him to be diplomatic in his ways and discerning with his speech, and he is. For example, in the book, the Finch family has a very old and unpleasant neighbor named Mrs. Henry Lafayette Du Bois. Mrs. Du Bois liked to yell at Scout and her brother Jem from her front porch, highlighting all of the things that their widowed father was doing wrong in raising them. Now, in spite of her less than desirable demeanor, Atticus would always greet Mrs. Du Bois by sweeping off his hat, waving gallantly at her, and saying, "Good evening, Mrs. Du Bois, you look like a picture this evening." Now, Scout does notice that she never actually heard Atticus say, like, what picture she looked. Now, he could have thought she looked like the picture of the screen, while Mrs. Du Bois, on the other hand, was thinking more along the lines of girl with a pearl earring. But if it was the scream running through Atticus's head when he thought of Mrs. Du Bois, he did make it sound lovely, didn't he? You look a picture this evening. You see, words matter. And our choice in words determines whether we paint a positive or negative picture. Now, Jesus also talked a lot about words. And in his Sermon on the Mount, found in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus preaches about a number of things, with words in the form of oaths being one of them. In our scripture reading, we hear, "Again, you have heard that it was said to those who lived long ago, don't make a false solemn pledge, but you should follow through on what you have pledged to the Lord. But I say to you that you must not pledge at all. You must not pledge by heaven, because it's God's throne. You must not pledge by the earth, because it is God's footstool. You must not pledge by Jerusalem, because it's the city of the great king. And you must not pledge by your head, because you can't turn one hair white or black. Let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. Now that is so like Jesus, isn't it? To take this commonly accepted way of doing things and declare there is a better way. You see, in Jesus' time, a person's word was a legal contract. In order to seal a contract, you would swear on something, like putting something up for collateral. You might say something such as, "I swear on my house that I am telling the truth." So, in other words, if you were caught not telling the truth, you would surrender your home. In these situations, you would create rules of how to transfer property in case you broke your promise. And here in our scripture, is Jesus warning us against just that kind of behavior. He says that if you need a contingency plan for what will happen if you break your promise, then something isn't right up front. Instead of swearing on collateral and creating these legal contracts for what will happen if something goes wrong, Jesus offers instead, just don't break your promises in the first place. Be a person of your word. Let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. What I think Jesus is implying here is that words, they are only as powerful as the speaker's integrity. Now, words take on different meanings when they are spoken by different people, and words are only as good as the person who is speaking them. And while it might be true that actions speak louder than words, it is also true that words receive their power through the actions of their speaker. Our actions determine how others judge our integrity, which determines how much weight our words carry. I know if I've ever said about a person, "I don't trust him as far as I can throw him," yeah, the chances are his words mean very little to me. He can make me a promise if he wants, but I certainly won't be holding my breath until that promise comes true. When we give people reasons to discount or distrust us, then our words quickly begin to lose their meaning. Now, on the other hand, you have people like Atticus Finch, whose word is his bond. Atticus's main storyline in To Kill a Mockingbird is that he takes on an unwinnable case, defending a black man named Tom Robinson. Now, we'll hear more about Tom when we come together on the 25th, but in this story, he is accused of assaulting a woman named Mayella Yule, with Mayella's father, Bob, being the ringleader of these accusations. Remember how we said everyone in Macomb had their social standing? Well, though the Yules are poor, they are also white, which seals Tom's fate before the trial even begins. And Atticus knows this. He knows that he and Tom will lose. But while any other lawyer would have half-heartedly gone through the motions on Tom's behalf, Atticus takes the case to fight the good fight. He strives to, at the very least, get the jury thinking about their preconceived notions and their treatment of people who look differently than they do. Atticus knows he can't single-handedly overturn systemic racism in his small southern town. But by genuinely defending Tom Robinson, who he knows is not guilty, he is metaphorically taking a chisel and a mallet and attempting to chip away at least some of the racism that exists there. Furthermore, Atticus knows that to deny a person the right to a fair trial would ruin his own integrity, even though seeking a fair trial for a black man ruined his reputation among the close-minded citizens of Macomb. But for Atticus, true integrity wins out over perceived reputation in this story, as it should. Now, when I first studied To Kill a Mockingbird in school, we spent a lot of time talking about how Atticus was the hero of this story. All of our literature needs a hero and a villain, and that's what we talked about. But in a classic literary sense, or in the way that our popular media today typically portrays a hero, Atticus really isn't. You see, heroes always fix the problem, and they always win in the end. If the hero loses, his or her story fails. Superhero movies never end in failure, do they? But you see, Atticus is no superhero. No, I would say that Atticus is more like a saint. The word hero, in fact, rarely appears in Scripture and never in the New Testament. The word saint, on the other hand, depending on the translation you're looking at, appears upwards of over 60 times throughout the New Testament. So, what is the difference between the hero and the saint? Matt Rowell in his book offers four main differences that I want to touch on today. The first one is who the story is about. The hero's story is principally about the hero. The saint's story is about what God is doing in the world. In To Kill a Mockingbird, Atticus's storyline isn't really about Atticus the super lawyer. No. Instead, we hear him talk about how he hopes his children won't catch the town's usual disease of racism. He is working for peace and justice. It's his hope for what God would do in Macomb, and our hope for what God can do in our world. Second, we look at why the story is told. The hero's story is told to celebrate the hero's accomplishments. The saint's story is told to celebrate a gift of faith. Let's take, for example, Mrs. DeBose in To Kill a Mockingbird. Remember that we said Mrs. DeBose is that neighbor who is initially portrayed as a very bitter and very racist woman. But her deeper struggle becomes clear when Atticus reveals that she is determined to free herself from a morphine addiction before she dies. Despite the immense pain, she gradually weans herself off the drug with the help of Jem reading to her on a daily basis as a distraction. Mrs. DeBose's victory over her addiction teaches Jem and Scout that the real courage in the world is about fighting a difficult battle, even when success seems like it may be unlikely, but because it is the right thing to do. And third, we look at what the story takes for granted. You see, the hero story assumes that conflict is necessary to prove that good is more powerful over evil. The saint assumes that nonviolence is the way to show that good wins. Atticus Finch embodies the saint's approach to conflict. When he defends Tom Robinson against a lynch mob outside the Macomb jail, he does so with nothing more than a newspaper, a reading lamp, and a rocking chair. They're symbols of his commitment to justice and truth and calm resolve. And by embodying patience and reason and his unwavering principles, Atticus challenged the mob's intentions, and he upholds the dignity of the law. You see, his nonviolent stand illustrates that true strength lies in the power of good to endure and outshine evil, proving that justice and righteousness can prevail without resorting to violence. And finally, we look at when the story goes wrong. The hero has to win. If the hero loses, his or her story fails. The saint shows that through weakness, we find strength. We hear, "My grace is sufficient for you," in 2 Corinthians. With a deck that is stacked against him, Atticus can't fix the problem of Tom Robinson being accused of something that he didn't do. He can't fix the problem of the jury deciding on Tom's guilt before they ever even hear his side of the story. In his book, Rawl notes that Atticus believes in the beauty of the justice system, not because it is flawless, but because he believes it is the best environment in which to discover and share truth. In his closing arguments, Atticus shares that all humanity, not one race in particular, shares in the world's immorality. It's his attempt to make the jury see Tom Robinson as an equal that actually causes Atticus to lose the case. He could have pandered to the jury's assumption that Tom Robinson was inferior because of his race. He could have claimed that Tom didn't know any better or that he couldn't control himself. But Atticus maintained Tom's innocence, calling out the white family that was accusing him. At this time and in this place, it was just too radical for the jury to accept that Tom Robinson was just as human as they were. But still, Atticus fought to challenge people's beliefs so that a new and more hopeful narrative might be born. You see, for the saint, the victory isn't always in winning or saving the day. It's in doing what is right and good, even if the outcome doesn't always work out in your favor. And isn't that too what we see in Jesus' story? It's not a hero story about strength or might or power. Instead, Jesus' life exemplifies humility, grace, and love as the true sources of strength. Throughout his life, Jesus chose the path of humility, associating with the marginalized, healing the sick, and offering compassion to sinners. His teachings, his words, centered on the power of love and sacrifice, rather than on worldly power or status. Unlike a hero who might conquer through force or domination, Jesus taught and lived a message of love and forgiveness, even towards those who persecuted him. So let's ask ourselves, how are we using our words to make a difference in our community and in our world? Are we inviting people to church? Now, that doesn't even necessarily mean here into the sanctuary on a Sunday morning, although that's a good place to be. You know, I was just amazed, and my heart was so warmed yesterday being here for part of the time of the fall kickoff splash bash with our new youth directors and the kids who came. Because we had youth who invited and brought their friends to just come and hang out and be in fellowship with one another. And it was amazing. So are we doing that? Can we learn a lesson from our youth in this regard? Now, are we telling God's story as it has been revealed through our lives? Are we reminding people that Jesus loves them? I mean, it's something that seems so simple, but it is so necessary. And here's where it can get a little more difficult. Are we backing up those words that we do say with our actions? Are we showing the love of Christ in all that we do? Are we living like people who have been saved and are being transformed by a living God? Are our actions backing up our claims to be people of integrity? Now, these are some tough questions. And if some of them make you a little uncomfortable, then I urge you to sit with that discomfort when you have some time and pray about it. We learn and we grow when we are challenged to be the best children of God that we can be. Just like Atticus Finch does with that jury, the Holy Spirit is always chipping away at that which makes us less than what God wants us to be. For Atticus, the courtroom is where truth is proclaimed. For us, that truth begins right here. Because if we can't proclaim the truth in the church, then we are never going to be able to proclaim it to the world. Atticus talks to his children about not being able to understand a person until you put on his skin and walk around in it. It is here in the church where we are challenged by someone else putting on our skin. Friends, that is literally the meaning of incarnation. Jesus put on skin and walked around in it. He lived and died in it so that we might have the freedom to walk around in our own skin today. What a gift. And as we go about living in that precious freedom, I pray that we speak every word like it matters, and that our integrity allows our words to carry weight for the kingdom. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to enter into a time of prayer now. And as I do each Sunday, I want to encourage you all to use this time for individual prayer, for meditation, for contemplation, to prepare our tithes and offerings to support the ministries and missions of the church. As always, those can be placed in the baskets at the back of the sanctuary or given online. But St. Mark's is a community that believes in the power of prayer. We understand that God can break through any barrier that we might have if we just open ourselves to the power of the Holy Spirit living in and through us. So in just a moment, I'd like to lead us in a centering moment and then have us all join together in our breakthrough prayer, which you'll find printed in the bulletins or up on our screens. And then we take that time to open our hearts and our minds to see and to hear and to feel how the Holy Spirit is speaking inspiration to us today. And during our special music, I'd encourage you all to continue listening for how God is speaking to you individually today. I'll then lead us in a time of prayer for others and ourselves and ask you to join me as you are led in the Lord's Prayer. But first, let's begin by closing our eyes as you feel comfortable, taking a deep breath in, slowly exhaling it to center ourselves in this moment. And then let's pray together our breakthrough prayer. God, open doors to reveal new hopes and dreams for St. Mark's and in our own lives. Give us the courage to follow where you lead. Amen. Gracious and loving God, we come before you today with hearts open to your voice of truth, desiring to live lives of integrity where our words and actions align with your will. Grant us the wisdom to speak with honesty and the courage to act with sincerity, that our words might be a reflection of your love and our promises be kept faithfully, honoring you in all that we do. We lift before you, God, the many needs of your people. We pray for those who are weighed down by burdens too heavy to carry alone. For those struggling with illness, may your healing hand bring comfort and strength. For those facing uncertainty and fear, may your peace, which surpasses all understanding, guard their hearts and their minds. We pray for the lonely, that they may feel your presence, and we pray for the grieving that they may be comforted by your love. We also bring before you the leaders of our community and our nation. Grant them wisdom and discernment in their decisions, that they may lead with justice and compassion. And we ask that you would bless those who serve others selflessly, whether in their families or workplaces or communities. May their efforts be fruitful, and may they find joy in the work of their hands. Help us all to be instruments of your peace, Lord, that we might speak words of hope and truth to those in need. Guide us to live lives that are consistent with the faith that we profess, bearing witness to your love in all our interactions. As we seek to be faithful to you, we unite our voices together now, praying as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I'd like to invite you all to stand once again as you're led and able, and join us in our closing song today, proclaiming the truth that we know, that we are not afraid with God on our side.
This confidence because I've seen the faithfulness of God, the still beside the storm, the promise of the shore. I trust the power of your word, enough to seek your kingdom first, beyond the barren place, beyond the ocean waves. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. You keep the promises you made. There isn't one that needs delay. So I will run your stars. Here I will lift my arms and start to sing into the night. My praise will call the sun to rise. Declare the battle won. Declare that it is done.
As you leave this place, this time, this space that we've spent together, may you carry with you the courage to speak truth, the strength to act with integrity, and the love to bring light into the lives of others. May your actions ripple out to make a difference to all those that you encounter. Let's go change the world. Amen.
Not so fast. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. I believe it is your birthday today. So we're just going to do a quick little happy birthday. One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Karla. Happy birthday.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Love you all.